we're going to be working with many, many, many of them going forward. We asked a lot of them, and they delivered. So any shortcomings that anyone perceives with the 2023 campaign should be directed towards me. Those guys did absolutely everything asked of them, which was a lot. And they're a really special group of guys, and they had a great season. And unfortunately, you know, just didn't have a good outcome in the division series. You know, it's a round bat and a round ball and a round earth that we live in. And sometimes the ball just doesn't bounce your way. And I think that happened for a lot of our guys, but they did everything they could to gear up and prepare for it, and I'm very, very proud of that, of this group.
What do you think is the number one priority for you now to improve the ball to go to that next
step? You know, obviously, we're looking to get better, and we also have to look to maintain. That's part of the game, too. You know, there's areas where just maintaining takes effort. And so we're going to be doing all that. I am looking forward to doing it in a professional way and sitting down and analyzing and talking to people. And one of the unwanted consolation prizes of getting eliminated early is you have a little bit more time to prepare for the off season. So we are sprinting ahead with doing that as a baseball ops department. We got people upstairs right now cranking on it, and I'm already going. So I don't have huge specific answers about what we're going to be out there looking for doing. Not ready for that yet. We're going to start putting the thought and the work into those very important questions right now.
Mike, are there any players who are going to have surgery, any medical concerns that we didn't know about going forward?
Not in any significant way, to my knowledge at this time, no. Felix is going to go rehab in Sarasota. In the next couple days, he's going to start that. And John Means is in good shape. We got him checked out. His elbow just kind of barked at an unfortunate time for him. But we've gotten it looked at, and he's going to be fine. So he'll be a full go in spring training. No, nothing needed for treatment with him other than just kind of time and rest.
How much did that injury impact you guys in the ALDS? And are you able to tell us kind of what the plans were for John Means during that series if he had been healthy?
I think we missed him. I think there's a good chance. You know, whether he started one of those games in Texas or didn't, that he was going to pitch a lot and pitch importantly. And it obviously, you know, that has some trickle-down effect to decisions on the rest of the staff. We missed him. He's one of our best pitchers. You know, the guy came out of nowhere and saved our division title in Cleveland, and I'll never forget that.
Mike, when you look at that, you know, the starting staff throughout the season, but then also in the playoffs, how much is a guy towards the top of the rotation something that you feel this team needs to take the next step, and how realistic is that to obtain it in an offseason?
I'm going to be kind of boring today with specific, you know, positional roster questions. All that stuff is swirling through my mind. The questions that you have are swirling through my mind, and all the other professional baseball people that we have working here. And we listen, we think, we self-reflect. You know, I got to really sit down and look at things and look at what's out there in the market. And you can't force stuff. And sometimes the market is the market, and you need to know what's there before you start picking and choosing your goals. So I just, you know, this is very fresh. You know, we just got off a plane. I'll have probably a lot more to say later. Well, I wish we made a better playoff run. You know, the regular season, I mean, 101 wins in the American League East. We were dreaming of that when we started the rebuild. It seemed impossible. And, you know, the people here pulled it together, and I think it's just a historic achievement. This group of players, regardless of where else they go in their careers and their lives, I hope that the city of Baltimore remembers this group for kind of reminding the world that, you know, this is Baltimore and we do baseball here. And that's, you know, my goal going forward, as long as I'm responsible for keeping that being the case. And it's the guys in that room that really made it happen. I think it had to have. I mean, I winter meetings, and I probably didn't say it perfectly, but in our division, to make yourselves the favorite in our division is really, really hard. And it's going to be hard again next year, too. We've got five organizations that know what the hell they're doing, that are some really big cities. One of them's a country. And we're all going for it. I don't think there's another division in baseball where their five teams came out at the beginning of the year and said, we're all going for the playoffs. We were the only one. We beat each other up all year. It was a couple of historic ways where you could say that was the strongest division in baseball history. I think the American League East, we ate some humble pie in the playoffs, and maybe we'll tone down the rhetoric a little bit this winter about our division, but we all know in our division what it's like, and I think we all have a shared respect for the experience that we all have in the American League East, you know, that's going to be the case next year.
Mike, some of the deficiencies this club may have had, how much of that might have been just because they exceeded your expectations so much?
It's a young group with a lot of steps forward that occurred as we were watching midseason. Credit to the players, as I've said, but also credit to the coaching staff and the support infrastructure that we've built for them. Maybe there's some of that because, this was developing in 2023 as it happened. But I don't want to stress the shortcomings of this roster given what it accomplished. We've got a lot of people around here that are very serious about winning, and we fell short. And so we're all individually going to reflect on things that we could have done better, even though a lot of great things happened this year. I think that's how you stay a champion or become. We won a championship this year, it was American League East, but there were a couple others that we fell short of. And so we're all going to work on ways to better our chances for those next season. Speaking from personal experience, I think sometimes when you stand somewhere and talk to the media and try to say things and have them be interesting for 40 minutes, things don't come out exactly how you meant them, or especially little snippets of what you said. We are very focused on keeping this organization as successful and healthy as possible within the constraints of reality. And a big part of that, obviously we have players here that we love, and you look at it right now and you go, boy, I wish we had those guys under contract for longer than they currently are. And a big part of the calculus of keeping this franchise healthy is pursuing or examining opportunities to, possibly keep some of these guys longer. And so I've said it over and over, we quietly work on this in the background. I don't want to be the one out talking about it, but obviously that's a part of our job as a front office to tackle that subject.
Mike, obviously you guys have a really good farm system right now. You talked during the deadline, how you're getting calls for some of those guys. Have you thought about what the plan may be for some of the guys who may look like they're major league ready but don't have the spots here? Just thought about how you want to go about all the talent that you have in the farm system.
It's all I think about every day of my life, how to do this stuff. And I'm not wanting to talk about it. I think I want to reflect on 2023, promise everybody and the fans that we're keeping our foot on the gas pedal for keeping Baltimore baseball great and having a even better season next year, and especially in the postseason, if we, to whatever degree we can control that. And there's a lot that goes into it, and we have an amazing farm system, and that's there's a lot of ways that that benefits you. So it's a good thing. We're going to do our jobs this winter.
Mike, you just alluded to it. I mean, every team that suffers a season-ending loss, you're in the locker room, you hear the clubhouse afterward, we'll be back. Do you believe that this team has more reason to believe that than a lot of teams that are in that position?
You know, the only thing that tempers any kind of, I don't know if enthusiasm is a word, but is our division's hard. And so I don't take anything for granted. Do we have the talent and the organization to have another regular season as successful as our regular season was? Absolutely. But, you know, there's other organizations out there trying to, and we're going to have 162 games next year, and a lot's going to happen. But I am exceedingly confident we're going to have another very competitive, entertaining, excellent season next year. What that results in, wins and losses, or division titles, or that stuff, you know, I'm humble about how hard it is and what this group achieved next year. But we're going to pursue that stuff. We've had a couple of really big milestones the last couple of years. This one was huge, and I'm very proud of it, and we want to do it again.
Mike, to get a little specific, obviously Gunnar has had a very good season for you guys. But how much weight do you give for the three-game appearance and the ALDS when he has a performance like that? I mean, do you look at that as a talent evaluator and think, okay, like Gunnar's going to be able to replicate this in coming postseasons?
If he had gone 0-for, I wouldn't think any less of him. But, you know, everything that he does at his age and the way he does it is it's a treat to watch. For me, as somebody who's been watching baseball my whole life, it's a treat for me to watch Gunnar Henderson play baseball. I'm so happy that we have him. Can't say enough good things about him.
Mike, you mentioned, obviously, you know, that there were shortcomings this year, but there were also a lot of bright spots, too. When you look back at the smaller moves made, O'Hearn, Coulomb, and kind of some other guys down the line, how pleased are you with how maybe some of those less moves that weren't so much in the spotlight kind of panned out for you guys?
I don't. We don't win the division or 101 games without Danny Coulomb, Ryan O'Hearn. There's other people that I'm going to forget, so I don't want to rattle through the list. But great outcomes with those moves. I think it's a product of having a front office process that's, in my estimation, sound. But you're not going to get that all the time. And, you know, we didn't hit on 100% of the things that we did. I'm happy that it happened, but I'm really focused on trying to do it next year and do better.
Sometimes players sign to, I guess what the industry might call mid-level free agent contracts can have major impact in October. You look at a guy like Evaldi, he's impacted two series already for Texas. He was like a 60 million dollar guy, however that contract's gonna play out. If the front office decides that level of guy is our guy that can really make a difference, can you make that deal? Are you authorized to make that deal?
Yeah, I look at everything on a case by case basis, and you know, there are players and trade targets that we have pursued in the last 12 months that we didn't get them. And you know, we're in the ranges that you're alluding to, and I, you know, that those pursuits will be on the menu again. We're trying to win, and we, you know, those types of deals are obviously a part of that. Doesn't mean you have to do them any given year, but we will be talking about them and doing what we got to do to have another great season and an even better season, and then also seasons and seasons after that.
Are you a long list of arbitration-eligible players this year and the past that's been making some difficult decisions on guys who have been here a long time that can move on? Have you given any thought to what that could look like this year, and do you anticipate that those tough decisions
I think looking at the arbitration list writ large, it's a healthy group. I think the fact that we have so many is it's kind of an earmark of having a good roster these days. I mean, you know, it's the teams that have a lot of guys like that, you can look at the franchises and they're usually in really good shape. It's a really good group. I'm not going to start talking about specific individual business in any corner of the organization right now, but it's a really good group of players, and they had good seasons, and they're going to get raises through the system.
Mike, between those raises and free agents coming off, should fans expect a higher payroll next season?
I'm just in day one of our off season. That's my answer. I sure hope so. I think you know, that's been increasingly the case here the last couple of years. You know, I think, you know, we've now had Jordan Lyles and Kyle Gibson come here on 1-year contracts and have really great years and great experiences. And you know, it's something that's really important for me to have a good environment for players. We talk constantly about how best to do that. I think it showed this year. I mean, I think our clubhouse was wonderful. A lot of people to credit for that, but we want this to be a great place to play.
Well, this falls into probably either the boring category or the keep trying category. But given the fact that you guys, that the rebuild has gone the way it has, and that Brandon Hyde likely will be manager of the year, there are some questions as to, with all of that success, what is the stability of the front office, Brandon, coaching staff, et cetera. We know you guys are around, but we don't know any specifics on that, something you really have not spoken about. Can you give us a sense of how long Brandon Hyde are here with the Orioles?
I approach this position that I'm in to maximize our ability to be successful and winning, and it comes sometimes at the expense of putting information out there or you know, feeding public info. And I don't see how it's beneficial to the Orioles team for that knowledge to be out there for our leadership or for anyone, for our coaches, for our scouts. You know, everyone who's here, while they're here, has full support. To talk a little bit about your question, and me and Brandon, we are 100% in on this. We're giving our hearts and souls and minds and quite a bit of experience to this, and I hope that lasts forever.
There are some high-profile jobs out there, though, in both your discipline and his. Is it fair to say that you guys will not be involved in those this offseason?
Yeah, we're back next season. I'll give you that. Good work.
The replacement in 2024 for Felix, do you think he's on the roster right now, or combination?
Yeah, another question that's been on my mind. That is a massive hole. I don't even think we felt it totally, just with the way the games went in after he got hurt. It's going to be tough to replace him, so we're going to bring all of our brain power towards answering that question.
Hey, Mike, you guys won 100 games, Dodgers won 100 games, Braves won 100 games. Two of the teams are already out of the postseason. Braves are trailing. Do you think the 5-day layoff is a bad thing?
It's interesting. I'm following it, and I'm aware of what's going on with the other teams, like you are. First of all, I don't want to make that as an excuse. I do not believe that was the difference between us winning or getting swept in the ALDS the way we did. So I don't have a big opinion about it.
Did the balance schedule help you guys this season, or did the being though you didn't have to play the American League East as much?
I thought it would going into the season. It's a good question. I haven't really looked at it or thought about it looking back now. And I think our record against the AL East was good and maybe better against our generic record. So I don't know. I'd have to take a look at that. That's an interesting question.
As you start planning out your roster for next year, are you expecting Jackson Holliday to be a part of it?
He'll be at Major League Spring Training. He was last year. He didn't have a full season anywhere because he moved so fast, but he, you know, hasn't been in AAA terribly long, but he did pretty well. I think when you're 19 and then you're 20, it's 1 year, but that's a lot of aging and physical development. I can't wait to see what he looks like in spring training. Look forward to having him there. He's going to have a chance to make the team. I lament that our outcomes at the trade deadline, didn't propel us through the ALDS. On the other hand, I was very focused on winning the division, and we did that. And we had some guys that came in and sort of helped fill some holes at the right time to rest our pitching staff, and I think that was helpful. We had all kinds of things going on at the trade deadline that just didn't happen. Like I said, for the players, sometimes the ball bounces and doesn't go your way. But it's absolutely something that we reflect on and want to do better. And again, as I said, I think that, to people that are focused on our shortcomings this year, which, you know, to me, I mean, we had a great year, but we fell short. Those are best directed at me, and that's the way I'm going to approach it this winter as we think about how to get better. But also this group and this front office, we use methodologies and philosophies. We're constantly curtailing them and trying to make them better, but we use methodologies and philosophies that got us from the depths of despair to where we are right now as an organization. And we use them because they work. And, you know, you don't want to betray them too often, because I think we've proven that, we've got good information and good guiding principles and good people. So that's my thoughts on that.
Mike, the myriad young pitchers who went through the season set highs and innings totals or games, how beneficial can the season be going forward?
That's been a big topic a lot the last few years coming out of COVID. And yeah, I mean, I hopefully that's increasingly less of a problem for our Orioles pitching staff. These guys banked a ton of experience, and including the postseason experience too. So I think they'll be better off for it.
Mike, we saw down the stretch for the AL East, and obviously the series, Brandon had a very active managing style, making a lot of moves in games, and that had a good outcome in the AL East race, and not in the ALDS. How do you evaluate that, and what do you make of Brandon sort of at the helm of a team with stakes?
I thought he had an unbelievable season. He's going to win manager of the year. He should. If he doesn't, I don't know what happened, but he had a great season.
Mike, what kind of year was it for the international program? It seemed like there were some honors for guys even beyond the CIO. How big will that be for you to try to keep a highly rated farm?
You see it now. I mean, you look at our prospect list, you look at Basayo, and I'm reminded of still the lack of international presence from the Orioles. I mean, the group of Latin players on this roster is kind of small still, and we want that to just grow and grow and grow. We're off to a great start. We're past the I'll use the word hangover phase of not having an international program and kind of being behind. I feel like that's over. The academy is looking great. It should be done. We should be in there this off season. I'm excited about our international program and Kobe Perez getting this thing off the ground. There's few people in baseball that were capable of doing that.
You mentioned the methodologies and the philosophies of the organization and the success of them to get you to where you guys are now. But now moving forward, you have a new data point, which is the postseason. The first one didn't go well. How do you weight the small sample and the randomness of a postseason versus the large sample of a 162-game season?
I think that we want to overweight our failures when we go and self-reflect over the winter and try to push ourselves to get better. That said, you know, if we're evaluating players or things like that, I don't want to get caught up in what they did in a three-game sample. So we're going to weigh it heavily as an organization, but in terms of like finite events on the field, you know, there's much larger samples to draw from.
Tyler Wells and DL Hall are two guys that started the season as starters and ended them as relievers. Do you view them as starting pitchers moving forward?
I'm going to plead the fifth again and not talk about specifics with the roster or the offseason. But look, that was both of those guys had difficult years. I mean, Tyler Wells, to start the season and be disappointed that you didn't make the All-Star team, and then for whatever reason, just kind of run out of gas or you know, just not have your weapons at your disposal that you're used to in the second half, go to AAA, get through that, and then come up and then pitch like nails in a playoff race at a time when he was badly needed. Was inspiring to watch. I wasn't surprised. I mean, I know what he's wired like, and I wasn't surprised. We were counting on him, and you know, he came through. And then DL, all the injuries, and going to Florida, and just being off the grid, and just getting it all together at the exact perfect moment when we needed him most, is one of the many things that I'm very proud of with this group of guys. Yeah.
Mike, this is the second year of the new left field wall. Do you have thoughts on it 2 years in, and should we expect the outfield to stay the same dimensions for the coming years?
I'm glad we did it. It coincided with winning baseball in Baltimore and a better style of baseball, which is kind of one of the things that we talked about. Is it perfect? Is it the exact perfect dimensions? Does it look perfect? Is it going to stay that way forever? No, and I don't know. But, you know, we're going to be renovating the stadium through this new agreement in the next few years. I don't have any specifics, but I'm totally open to that being on the table, and especially from maybe a smoothness or aesthetic standpoint. I think that's something that we should talk about and take a look at. But I definitely like not having the most ridiculously homer prone left field in the league. That wasn't good. So we changed it as quickly and as realistically as we could at the time, and seems like it worked.
All right, thanks everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it was our bullpen became a bunch of short relievers, short inning relievers, and so we kind of went in expecting into the workout phase postseason that we're going to have John available to start one of the games, and just one of those things that happened. It's unfortunate, but it happened, and it didn't allow us to have one of our starters go in the bullpen. Yeah.
And you guys have long said, you were looking at a starter, and without the two stuff for next year, is he somebody that you might recommend be considered as a...
We haven't even discussed, honestly, DL's role next year. I'm just so excited about how he threw the ball in September and how he threw the ball on the national stage. Whatever we decide to do with him, he's going to be a huge part of our team next year. But that was an unbelievable performance of the two games he pitched in the postseason. And he wasn't really stretched out to those two type of innings either, just the kind of the way it fell. And he was just fantastic. So down the stretch into the postseason, he showed everybody the kind of pitcher that we've been waiting for. And he's going to be a big impact for us going forward. Well, I have so many great feelings. I mean, the way it ended was awful and sucked, and we're wearing that still. But it was a really successful season, and overcoming so many odds and obstacles that are against us, and so many people thinking that we weren't going to be a playoff team, and all of a sudden we win 101 games and win the American League East. I mean, that says a lot about a lot of people in the organization, a lot of guys in that clubhouse. So I'm really proud of that, but we had so many awesome moments and, huge wins and close wins, and the amount of close games we played was ridiculous, and how we won some games, during the season, it was just a total team effort, and that's how we played all year. And, unfortunately the postseason, we just didn't play our best and, ran into a little bit of a buzzsaw, but I'm gonna have great memories of this team. No, I mean I'll watch. I'm gonna watch a little differently this year. I'm gonna watch a little irritated, to be honest with you. I'm still irritated. I'm still frustrated. Still pissed. So when I watched I watched the Diamondbacks last night, I'm really happy for Torrey Lovallo and one of my best friends, Jason McLeod, over there in Arizona, and Mike and Amiel and what they're doing over there. That's a fun team to watch, so I was happy to watch those guys last night.
Brandon, when you talk to your guys who are there, to a perspective now, what's your sense of how they see the future?
Say that again with 10? Say that again. Well, yeah, but there's not many players. I don't know how many guys are still here, and most of the guys are getting on in the car or going in an airplane probably right now. But spent the morning with him yesterday, the team flight back. I think guys are very disappointed, but I think they're very aware of what they accomplished this year, and they should. It's really, really hard what we did, and it's really, really hard what we did after – losing 110 games 2 years ago. That's unprecedented. And so they need to know that, and they need to understand that. And we came up short of what we expected out of ourselves. But there's a lot to be proud of, and there's a lot to – the guys are going to be back. There's going to be a lot to look forward to because they're really good players. Whenever we lose any sort of game, whether it's in April or the postseason, I take it as harder than anybody else. And so when things don't work out the way that you want them to work out, I mean, I wear it big time. So whether it's division series or a game against Texas in April, you know, I take losses hard.
Granted, to that point, obviously a lot of your players have gone through the postseason the first time. That wasn't your case, but it was your first time in this role. What did you kind of learn from those games?
Well, it was three unusual games. I mean, the first game was a game that we won a lot of how that game was played. We won that game a lot, and it just didn't happen. We had scoring opportunities and just couldn't cash in. They made it, you know, Young made a great play at third base in a big spot after Chappie had a tough time commanding, you know, in the inning. And it just didn't go. I feel like we didn't get any bounces or breaks. And then it's tough to play catch up in the postseason and from the second inning on. That's just bottom line. And so there's a lot of things to look back and you wish, you know, things went differently. Yeah, I haven't even had those discussions with Mike. Me and Mike are going to talk about that, you know, in the coming days. But I thought our guys did a great job and a huge part of why we won 101 games.
Brandon, you said a bunch of times that the talent of the roster is a huge reason for the jump in the last season. But what has it been like for you as a manager to kind of see, you know, your moves and decisions and your wins kind of reach that higher stage to the point where you're being discussed in these conversations about manager?
I don't... That's nice. I'm still pissed, to be honest with you. So I don't, you know, I'm disappointed and I mean, I don't really read a ton and I try to keep my focus. I mean, when the season's going on, honestly, like all I'm worried about is that night's game. And so what's happening around me, sometimes I'm not aware of, or I'm being told, but, I'm just trying to get better every day, honestly, and I'm just trying to put our team in position to win as much as I possibly can. So, you know, whatever people say, they say, and if it's nice things, that's great.
Brandon, for a long time around here, we've been wondering where we have a number one starter, and we're looking for towards free agency or a big trade.
Right.
Even with Bradish's growth this season, the club has like a real number one.
I think it's got an opportunity to be a number one. I think a lot, I mean, when you talk about number one starters, it's a handful in this league. True number ones. And it's hard to be a true number one. So, does he have the ability to? Absolutely. Does Grayson have the ability to? Absolutely. They're a ways away. You know what I mean? They're a ways away. A true number one is a guy that is going to stop any sort of losing streak, a guy that's going to, you know, go dominate a team in postseason, like those type of guys. And those are hard to find. But those two guys have the stuff and the ability to be that type of guy. Well, I'm hoping those guys develop into that, possibly. I don't know what we're going to do this offseason. That's not my department. I'm going to do the best I can with the roster that's given to me. I know Mike will be in discussions, and Mike will talk to me about roster stuff through this offseason and into the winter meetings and all that stuff. I can't believe that we're already talking about that. But we'll see. I honestly don't know what moves we're going to make or what additions we're going to do. Or, you know, we haven't even discussed next year at this time.
I guess to follow that, Mike said that he will give a lot more weight to individual performances over 162 games than what someone did in a three-game playoff series in terms of his outlook on a player going forward. Are you kind of in that same boat?
Yeah. Yeah, I think, you know, in the world of analytics, there's big samples and there's small samples. They tend to look at the big sample. So three games is kind of a small sample. It's also a first experience for a lot of those guys. And, you know, we're going to evaluate everything going forward. We just got our teeth kicked in, so we're still wearing it. Wow, that caused a reaction. Well, I don't think it helps. Let's put it that way. I don't know if what they're going to do. I know that there's a lot of things that are way more, people make a lot more money than I do that figure that out, and there's a lot more money involved than my opinion. So I don't know what they're going to do about that. I think it's a long time.
Brian, it was tough to manage these postseason games as is, but
Yeah.
What's the mindset of you as a manager at that point? Scramble mode? Like, what's going through your mind?
Well, you're at that point, you're just trying to stay in the game somehow, you know, try to give your team an opportunity to catch up. Without a long guy, especially in that second game, I knew everybody was going to pitch. And so it was like trying to find the right spot for every single person, knowing that if we could stay in this game, I'm going to need these certain guys later in the game and not, you know what I mean? So that was challenging, and that blew up on us, kind of that middle or the early third of that game. So I don't know. I mean, that's when you're starter gets knocked out in the second inning, the odds of winning are pretty low. Not that I'm thinking that at that time, but it's extremely challenging. And then when it happens twice, it's not easy.
That irritation you're feeling, is that something you learn to carry forward in some fashion, or is it something you eventually?
Probably not my strength. Oh, I don't like to lose. I don't like to lose, and I don't like to lose like that. And I wanted our players to jump around again, and I didn't want to, it's a really cool group. You didn't want to get on the plane after something like that. After losing like three, and you wanted to see them play, continue to play. That's the bottom line. You just didn't want the season to be over. I'm not really sure. I think the health, I'm sure, played a part into the lack of consistency, but he, said it was a big part of our team, and he wanted to be out there, and he wasn't giving indication that he was hurt of any sort, and I'm sure, like, everybody was banged up, and I know he needed those days off. But he didn't end the season very well, very strong, and still played great defense and looked healthy playing defensively, but just couldn't get going offensively there.
Brandon, you mentioned, of course, it's Mike's job to put together the roster in the offseason, but what's your role in the talent evaluation? What can you speak to a little bit the kind of conversations you guys have together?
Well, I think we take a little bit of a break, and then as the postseason wraps up, and we start talking about the roster next year and free agents that are available, and he'll clue me in on some of the targets and why and those type of things. That's I'm not heavily involved in the transaction process, or I think as we, like last year, once we start targeting free agents that we're interested in, then I become a part of the process of the recruitment process a little bit, where I talk to, like, there's a lot of guys we talked to last offseason, and I was a part of, talking about our organization and talking about our team to those players. So I'll be involved in that way. Yeah, I mean, I look back at all those players we talked to, the ones that didn't come here. We were pretty right on. We were honest. We thought we were going to be pretty good. We thought they could be a help. We thought that our team was going to be exciting and have a chance to win the AL East, and we were right. Everybody that from last year was very interested because of the talent we had on our team and the what we were going to look like going forward, and we said what we were going to do. Maybe a little bit more than we thought we were going to do, honestly, to start the year. So I think that's going to be the same way this year, where people are going to see that they enjoy playing here, and this is a fun team to be on, and we're going to win.
Brandon, you made the decision to play Gunner mostly short. A lot of managers would have buried a player like Mateo. You seem to still make sure he was part of the process.
Mm-hmm.
A lot
I do. I mean, there's only so many guys in the league that can run like him. There's only so many guys in the league that have that sort of talent. He's still kind of early in his career. I primarily played him against lefties the second half of the year, last 2 months of the year, kind of. Just because I thought I wanted to give him a little bit better opportunity, honestly. And he performed. He swung the bat well against left-handed pitching and made a difference for us when he was in the lineup against them.
As a follow-up, did you see his defense take a step back when he was playing part-time?
I think a little bit. I think also because he was out there more inconsistently, I think that might have played a part in that a little bit. But I think that he still could be a really special defender. I think that going from playing mostly every day to then being part-time, or there was some, you know, there was a run in early September-ish that I think we faced like 15 righties in a row. So he got really sporadic playing time there. And that's hard to do. It's hard to do to stay sharp defensively and also keep your mind right and ready. And that's something he's going to learn. I mean, he's still 3 years into his career, and so it wasn't like we're rolling veteran dudes out there that, you know, like Adam Frazier, if he didn't play for 5 days, knew how to, because he's been in the league for 9 years. And that's just part of growing up as a major league player.
The retention concern for you guys late in the year, Brandon, was the season inning limits for some individual pitchers.
Yeah. Well, I think, let's go, I mean, for me, the six-man, when we decided to go to a six-man rotation, that possibly was a season saver. Because I feel like all those guys, that was kind of crunch time a little bit, and it allowed all those guys to get an extra day, and they showed what they could be like when they're rested, and I think that was the right thing to do for every one of them because they were flying over their innings because they were all pitching so well, and we needed them. So, for me, that was a huge part of our season is when we made that decision at that point. You know that I'm excited about our rotation going forward. Like I said, I'm not sure what's going to happen from a roster standpoint, but I know that we have. Some guys in there that had great experience this year and had really good seasons and are still really young in their career. I mean, if you just go back what Tyler Wells did the first half and then we did the last week of the season, it's unbelievable. Arguably our best starting pitcher the first half, and then becomes, I don't think he gave up a run since he came back out of the bullpen and showed the kind of the stuff that he had out of the bullpen from a couple of years ago. So, our starting pitching is up and coming, and I think that they're only going to get better. Yeah.
How was he going into the game? Was there any thought to make a change there maybe before?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I mean, a lot of things. But he seemed good, and we would have probably needed him for game four if he didn't pitch game three. So, but he felt prepared for that day. We gave him a heads up that it was going to be that day. Then obviously a lot of things happened over the weekend. And I thought he was handling it extremely well. If that affected it, you know, that second inning or not, I don't know. But I give him a ton of credit for shouldering a lot and going to try to do what he did.
Friend, at the end of 2022, you talked about the leadership of Lyles and Ruggie.
Yep.
And how that would be difficult to replace.
Yep.
And this year you have Gibson and Frazier and Hicks. And you don't know what the situation
McCann.
Is. McCann. Well, McCann will be back.
Though. Yeah.
Gill and Fried, I'm 100% sure they're going to be back. How difficult is that? Or is that just kind of part of it? And do you expect other guys to step up?
Yeah, I would expect that we're going to, you know, possibly acquire veteran players also. I mean, that's an important part of the clubhouse. And we've, you know, Mike's done a great job of getting the right type of veteran guys in here. All those, you name six or seven of those guys, they're all have been incredibly helpful. Robbie still sends me texts. Robbie watches every game, those guys have been a huge impact on our younger players, and it's, you can't really see it out there, and nobody sees it, but we know it in the, inside the clubhouse what they do for them, the young guys, and I assume that will be the same way going forward.
How much would you like those, that trio, to come back?
Yeah, we'll see what happens. They're at a certain point in their career that they've earned to go do the whatever's best situation so for their family and so whatever's the best for them, I'm fully on board.
How do you feel like that middle group of the roster, as a group of players that's kind of been here throughout your tenure, has done in that regard and how they've grown into this group?
Yeah, I've seen a lot of growth. I mean, a lot of growth in Santander and Hayes. Mm-hmm. And how they're just more vocal now and established, and you know, Hazy starts the All-Star game, you know. Santander's the best switch hitters in the league. So just they've gotten older and they've had more experiences now, and they're not afraid to speak up. They've matured extremely well. They're fun to be around. Absolutely. I mean, it's a great group. I think they're going to come into spring training extremely hungry. And I think the expectations are going to be even higher, which is what we want. And we're looking forward to embracing those. But I'm just looking forward, you know, I just say goodbye to a bunch of them. I want them to enjoy their offseason as much as they possibly can. And looking forward to them, seeing them in spring. Ready to go.